reminder, this is your audience now. So if you're down here and you see a camera, that's your time to, you know, make eyes with them as if they're your audience. Yeah. We are in the historic Kilo Palace Theater, which was opened in 1925. There's something about being able to create here. This afternoon, I am directing Live from the Empty Palace, which is a series that I helped kick off when quarantine happened and the theater went dark. Phillips and myself and our co-producer, Drew Daniels, came up with the idea to showcase all of this amazing performance art talent that, you know, was hungry to work. Or do we want her to stand and then kind of sink out of frame? I've produced a lot of shows out here, but now I'm producing films that are set here, so clearly I'm pretty inspired by the location.
Water bottle. That's 2 points.
Tonight's just not your night.
Fanny pack.
Oh, dang. That's 8. Is there anything good inside? What?
Cashback is a 7-minute narrative short film. The idea of it actually came because of the availability of one of the actresses in it that I had been really hoping to work with. Her name is Grace Scanlon. She became pregnant with her first child, and that made me really excited about the opportunity to write a character of a young pregnant woman and have a young pregnant woman actually play her. COVID kind of got in the way of our plan there because we went into lockdown about 3 weeks before we were supposed to shoot. So we ended up having to push the production back. Grace had her daughter. We got a prosthetic belly. It's also kind of a world-building proof of concept for a feature that we've been trying to get off the ground. It uses the same characters like 5 years earlier. We were just sort of hoping that we would be able to kind of use it to show people the world that the feature would take place in. It's been a couple of years since I've been able to make a feature, and it's not because I haven't been trying. In the film scene in Hawai'i, we have very few female filmmakers making narrative feature-length work. I could only count 3 women in the last 30 years that had been able to make a narrative feature. The first one was Kaiohata in 94 with Picture Bride. The second one was me in 2019 with Stoke. And the third just came out this year, 2021, which was Jude Wang's Finding Ohana. And that's it. It's definitely access to financing I'm learning, because we've had a lot of men make narrative films in that time span. I mean, we had several narrative features come out in 2020 alone directed by men shot in the state. And it's not because we don't have a lot of women out here trying to make films.
Lava, bro.
Hey,
wait up.
Can you take me to the lava? This is you, yes? Big boys?
Yeah, it's us. I'm Dustin. This is Paul.
Jane, do you have an open spot today or maybe tomorrow? I've been calling places all morning and everybody has booked for days.
Stoke was shot on Hawai'i Island in 2017. It was produced with myself and my partner, Phillips Payson, who co-directed. We centered the story around the lava flow that had been flowing, I think, for like 30 years in Kalapana into the ocean, which is right where we live. Stoke follows an entitled tourist who comes out to Hawai'i Island to grieve, basically, and she hires 2 wannabe tour guides to take her to an active volcano.
We got a couple of types of lava. We got the hoi-hoi, slow-moving kind, oozing out like pancake batter. And now there is a-a, which moves faster, huh? As you can imagine, the lava impacts just about everything here on island. Tourism, real estate, you name it. There ain't nothing out here that you don't touch.
All 3 of the main characters from Stoke were born out of different perspectives that came from a documentary I was working on in 2014 called Aloha from LavaLand, where we were interviewing members of my community about their experience, you know, living on an active volcano and how that impacts their life. Kalapana, which is in the Puna District on the Big Island, has, I think, some of the most volcanic activity in the country. the same themes kept coming up over and over about impermanence. A lot of people came here who hadn't been born and raised here came here to deal with some kind of grief. You know, a seed sprouts in your brain, right? And then you just obsessively return to it, and these characters are born.
Did you really hire them to take you to the lava?
Yeah, I really did.
It's ridiculous, no offense, how people show up to see it.
Is it?
Yeah, it is. So many people, thousands and thousands, flying from God knows where to see a damn volcano before they can understand that the land is the law.
I went back and forth a lot about how to approach the cultural side of the volcano with the Hawaiian characters, because I am not Hawaiian, and I wasn't really sure how to give myself permission to go there.
Check it!
Yeah, I worked a lot with the actors, the Hawaiian actors who were playing those characters, and I also sent the script around to several cultural practitioners that I know to kind of explore what I was getting right, what I was getting wrong.
What's your deal?
You know my deal, cuz. Selling lava to tourists feels
like... Yeah, no pono, I got you already.
Yeah, bro. It's like selling trips to go meet Jesus or something.
I can't really access what it's like to be raised Hawaiian and to have this relationship with the land. You know, I'll never fully understand that. But I could talk about what it might feel like to have something that is so sacred to you commoditized for tourism. The centerpiece of our film, even though it's the end, it's like the core of the film takes place in front of an active volcano, which is a challenge in its own right. And a lot of people who watch the film, they're like, that was a green screen, right? And I was like, nope, they're on a boat. We can only fit 6 people on the boat, so I actually didn't get to go. I didn't direct that final scene because we were like, we needed our crew, we needed our 3 actors, and that was pretty much it. Phillips directed that final scene.
I like the lead.
Phillips was my best friend in high school. And then after college, friendship started kind of leaning towards romance, and he wanted to make a feature film. I wrote a script for him very quickly, and we shot like the second draft of it out here in Hawaii. From there, we did a couple more films together with him directing and me writing, producing. And then I co-directed Stoke with him. And then after Stoke, we kind of made this decision to creatively uncouple, we call it. We realized that we wanted to make different films. I still will produce for him, but in terms of like co-creating, we just realized we would both be making stronger work separately. Being able to do my own work kind of has given me a lot of independence, obviously, but I'm more confident now. There are a lot of people who make one film and they find out how hard it is and they don't ever get to make a second one. So my advice is always just to keep going. Keep finding new people to collaborate with, because this is a collaborative medium and you can't do it on your own, and just keep going, don't stop. Yeah. Woo.